Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining me on the show. This week on the show, on episode 118, the first episode of the new year. Happy 2019 to you all. The first episode of the new year, we're going to talk to Brianna Judge. She's a singer-songwriter. Just put out a new record. We're going to talk all about that in just a minute. But first off, how are you? How are you enjoying 2019 so far? We're about 14, 15 days into it at this point, and I hope it is everything that you wanted it to be and more. Mostly and more. That's really what I want because, you know, the limits of our own imagination are, you know, they're limited. That's why they're called limits. I want it to be everything you wanted it to be and more. That's right. That's what I want. From my heart. Welcome to the show. That's right. I wanted a little heartfelt thing right up at the beginning right there for 2019. Welcome to the show. Welcome to 25 O'Clock, Philadelphia's longest running music podcast, I think. If you're new to the show, old to the show, medium to the show, you should check us out. 25oclockpod.com. That's our website. That's our home in the world. In the digital world, 25oclockpod.com. And what can you do there? Well, you can do everything. Well, not literally everything, but you can do a lot of things. You can stream and download every single episode that's ever come out before. As I said at the top of the show, this is episode 118. You can stream and download all the other episodes, all the previous 117 episodes. My gosh, when I say that number out loud, it seems ridiculous. Do all that there at 25oclockpod.com. Check out the Friends and Neighbors page. That's where I link anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. So if you're listening to an episode and you like an artist, you like who you're listening to, go to the Friends and Neighbors page. Find them on the internet, in real life. Don't stalk them. That's weird. But, be polite. Do all that at 25oclockpod.com. Check out our mailing list, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, all those things, 25oclockpod.com. I want to do something this year in 2019, and we'll see if I remember to do this every episode, but it's something I just decided to do a second ago. Instead of taking the top of the show and talk about myself, although that'll probably happen anyway, I want to talk about a music thing in Philadelphia, a thing you might not know about, a thing that maybe I might not know about that much, but I found out about and I want to tell you about it. So I want to start off the new year right. I want to start off 2019 by telling you about a venue, a unique venue in Philadelphia. It's called the Music Ward. It's at 5101 Grace Ferry Avenue, and it's a DIY music venue, not a DIY music space, not a space that doubles as an art gallery or as an event space. This is a venue. I don't know the people who make up the Music Ward, but I know that they have really, really put in the work to make a music venue, a DIY music venue. It's not a bar. It's not a club. It's not a restaurant. It's not owned by a company. The Music Ward in Philadelphia, in Grace Ferry, 5101 Grace Ferry Avenue. You can check them out at themusicward.com. Tons of bands have played there. As I go and look at their site and realize all these groups that have played there, it's amazing. I know a lot of these bands. A lot of these bands have been on the show. Bands like All Boy, All Girl. I know they talked about the venue. Bands like Port Arthur, Driftwood Soldier, Lee Lee Lee. I've been calling them Lie 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 all this time. That's my friend Emily Mineo's band. Lee 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 have also played there. Koof Knotts has played there, and tons, tons more. So check them out at themusicward.com. It's a truly unique space, a truly unique venue, and one of these days, I will get off my ass, and I will actually go there, and then I will tell you about it. But in the meantime, check them out at themusicward.com. That's my thing. I think that's going to be my thing in 2019. I got no money from them. They don't even know that I'm going to shout them out on this show that an amount of people listen to. I don't want to be one of those people who be like, you know, one of those shows that no one listens to? I know people listen to this show, not a million people, but not two. So, you know, that's where I'm operating here on this show. Between two people and 1 million people listen to this show. I don't really go any further than that. But like I said, they don't, you know, Music Ward didn't ask me to do this. A lot of bands I know have played there. They seem like a super viable place. I want to help them out. Check them out, themusicward.com. That's my thing here in 2019. Gonna selflessly, without any sort of promotional idea in mind, just push things out there that I think are cool. And that's one of them. The Music Ward, 5101 Grace Ferry Avenue. Do it. Let's talk about Brianna real quick, because we're going to talk to Brianna for the rest of the episode. I don't want to be like, let's talk about it real quick, and then we're done. No, that would be silly. That would be a very short-lived episode where I talk for 5 minutes, and then we go away. Brianna Judge, you can check out her music at briannajudgemusic.com. That's two N's, B-R-I-A-N-N-A, judgemusic.com. She has a new record out called Wide Eyes. It was recorded at Turtle Studios here in the deepest of South Philadelphia's. She's got a gig coming up at Puck in Doylestown, a great club outside the city in Doylestown, on March 30th. She's a Temple alum. She's from the Northeast. And when I say the Northeast, I don't mean the Northeast United States. I mean she's from Northeast Philly, which is its own thing right there. And we had a great conversation. Her record's phenomenal. She's a great singer-songwriter. She's super fun to talk to. Let's get to it. Let's get right into it. My conversation with Brianna Judge, here on 25 o'clock. Five. Are you from Philly originally?
Yeah, I'm from, I'm from Bensalem, but like my parents are in Bensalem, but I went to high school in the Northeast, college at Temple, but technically, like, I could see Franklin Mills Mall, which I think now it's called the Mills.
The
like,
Mills.
Through the trees.
The outlet at the Mills or what have you. There's a Sam Ash up there.
Oh, yeah. That is home. That is home there.
Yep.
They know me and my dad. They're always like, every time I go in there, they're asking about my dad.
Yeah.
And,
because your dad plays, right?
Yeah, my dad plays.
Yeah. Yep. I was reading about you. You've been like, you said your dad had been in bands for like as long
Ever.
As you can remember.
Yeah.
And that's got to be, I mean, certainly explains a lot not just you getting into music at all, but you like particularly leaning towards like lead guitar and things. He was a guitar player?
Yeah, he was a guitar player. I wanted to be a drummer and my mom said no.
Too loud?
Too loud. My dad always had a guitar in the corner of the room. He never actually like, pushed it on us at all. Really.
It was just there.
And then, like, you know, he picks it up, he shreds. So he looks really cool doing it. Yeah. It's like, well, I want to be that good. And he's like, well, you got to practice. Like, you know, and then,
was he like, I mean, like he had been in bands probably since he was a teenager.
Yeah.
Like,
So I think he got, there's like this real, it's this really cool guitar shop name. That I think I wrote it in like my post about the Wide Eyes song, because that's the song that he soloed on.
Yeah.
I can't think of the name, but it's like no longer around, but it was somewhere in Northeast. But
it wasn't Cintioli's, was it?
Yeah.
Oh, Cintioli's. My God. They are gone. All right.
Yeah.
I haven't been up to that neck of the woods in quite a while, but I've been there many times.
Yeah.
That place.
Yeah.
That place was special.
He said, like, because I was asking him about it when he got that Gibson Les Paul that he has. That's in, like, mint condition. Mm-hmm. My dad is very particular about everything.
Yeah.
And he said he, like, his dad went there with him, and he got it for, like, so inexpensive.
Well, they were
a
lot cheaper.
Date.
Yeah, they were, like, cheaper back then.
Yeah.
Even based on, like, the money being different now, they sold them for cheaper back then. Yeah, you could get a Gibson Les Paul for, like, couple $100 or something like that. Yeah.
There's like this picture that I have of him. He's wearing like a denim shirt, denim jeans, like long hair. So like so 70s. And it's him in the basement of St. Anselm's in Parkwood.
Mm-hmm.
That's like where all of my family's from Parkwood, which actually like that's the part of Bensalem where I'm at where it kind of borders.
Yeah.
Because that's like Frank Mills's kind of like bent like Parkwood area.
Yeah.
And that's where we hung out. Like because if you're drinking in the woods and you're drinking in the Bensalem side and the cops come from the Bensalem cops, you run into the Philly side. And that's where.
It's good to know that kids never stop drinking
in the
woods.
Woods.
That's me. I mean, not now. That would be weird if I did it now. But no, that was me growing
Unless
up.
Unless you're camping. But.
Yeah. Well, no, that's different. That was growing up was definitely. Yeah. So you're hanging around the Northeast and like your dad's playing guitar, mm-hmm. and he was in bands like all when you were a kid. And
yeah.
Is he still in bands?
Yeah. So we were he was in like Rumpel Dumpty was his like first band. Like that's the one I have all these like 70s pictures of, like mm-hmm. classic stuff. And then he was in this band called Recall, which actually my now drummer and my dad are the only two living members left of that band. But the other two guys, another guy was named Charlie and Mike Sassani, and they were like super also influential in me and my music.
Yeah.
Because, you know, like I was the daughter who was actually interested in music. So they kind of like, well, here, try this mandolin, try this guitar, try that guitar. Like, oh, you're interested? Like they were just like donating.
This one seems to like it. yeah. How many siblings do you have?
I have one older brother.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And he's not so much as into music?
Yeah. So he was actually, so like my dad never pushed it on us, but like my brother's 5 years older than me, but we're really tight. And always just like, I totally idolized him. So like he was the one who picked up the acoustic. He taught me how to read tablature. And then, like, so that's, like, that's kind of when I picked it up was when Sean picked it up, my brother Sean.
But you seem to gravitate more towards the electric guitar. Well, I mean, you've got all kinds of guitars on your record, but...
Yeah. It's more so I'm gravitating towards the electric guitar because just kind of, you know, the acoustic guitar is what you do for, like, intimate sessions or, like, different things like that. But I just really want to hone in on my, you know, lead skills, really getting into tone right now.
Yeah.
Just like invested in a Jag. So
I saw a picture of that. Yeah. I was just like, I saw the thing. I was like, cool. Like, you can go down a real rabbit hole with tone.
Oh yeah, exactly. That's like really getting into that now. And it's just, you know, just kind of exploring that, kind of trying to make it my own. I think that's like, you know, growing up with my dad, always listened to like, well, Clapton is his guy, but I love Mark Knopfler.
Yeah.
Like, love his.
I mean, that's a talk like, about a tone right there. You can pick that tone out of a lineup.
Yeah.
Like that kind of Fender pickup in second position. I always call it the Fender quack pickup
because
it always sounds like kind of quacky.
Yeah, exactly. It's like the four guys, like I'd say Hendrix, like Jimmy Page, Clapton, and Mark Knopfler.
Mark Knopfler,
And Mark Knopfler does that really cool thing where he like, with his, because he never uses a pick, so like he kind of like brushes the string and
gets
this like kind of like delayed pickup. Like,
yeah. Yeah.
It's just, I'm very fascinated of the way he, like, you know, plays his leads, and it's nothing flashy.
Yeah.
It's like to complement the song itself.
It's funny, like, he's a real blues picker, like, with his hands and everything, mm-hmm. but then it's all run through, like, that tight, clean Fender Strat sound.
Yep.
So, like, it's really, really unique.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's not a loud guitar player mm-hmm. or particularly fast guitar player. I think like the fastest you get with him is like maybe some of those like arpeggios and like Salt to Swing or something like that.
Yeah.
Which really, once you figure out how he does it, you're just like, oh, that's not that fast.
No,
he's a really unique guitar player. He's got a cool voice too. Like he's
like not the best singer, but like a fantastic storyteller. I think he's the best songwriter out of the four of them.
I could see that.
I think Clapton has that like gold mine, like that gold mine and like Tears in Heaven.
Yeah.
You know, I think in terms of general storytelling, it comes from, and Mark is the guy.
I'd agree with that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's funny. Like I was actually just recently thinking like, cause you would think about like talking about Jimmy and like songwriting, like he was. Everything he wrote was before he was 27. So like, everything that exists of him is like in his mid 20s, like early to mid 20s. Like he's young, you know. I don't think he got the chance to kind of mature.
So did you take lessons with your father, or was he?
No.
He was just kind of like, here it is. If you want to get better, you got to work at it.
Yeah.
Now go work at it.
Yeah, he really didn't like. I remember, like, asking him, like, begging him to teach me in different things, but it was really just, like, when my brother showed me tablature, and that's when I kind of legitimately started learning chords. Like, he gave me that, you know, instruction book. He always kind of, like, he gave me the tools to teach myself. My dad is self-taught too. So it's like, and it's funny because I don't have patience either. Like, I get it now. Like, I totally understand at the same time. At the time, I was like, why? Like, I'm interested. I want this. Yeah. Like, he's like,
it takes a lot to teach someone.
Do it yourself. Yeah. Like,
and sometimes just because you know how to do something well doesn't necessarily mean that you would know how to teach someone how to do it well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was always like a consistent, like, and him and those guys, like Gary, Mike, and Charlie. Like, my dad's name is Charlie, but Charlie Helbling. You know, just that constant exposure. Like, all four of them are very good musicians.
Yeah.
And just having that constant exposure to them. They all were also, well, Charlie and Mike were also songwriters. So they kind of bit onto me and my interest in songwriting. You know, different things like that, just like super influential. So just that consistent exposure, especially like right now, like really working with my dad in the band and my music in this project. I think it's always good to have people around you who are better than you.
And oh, absolutely. Like, yeah.
It's the only way you get better.
Don't be the best person in the room. That means you have to get new people.
Yeah. So, and it's cool because like, I think my dad, like, for example, there's this like, I kind of use it, like in 2 AM. It's like a finger plucking style. It's the same, like the style that is used in Dear Prudence. It's just like that.
Oh yeah.
Style of, like finger playing with the guitar. Like I remember like showing that to my to my dad, and he was so frustrated because it was like something that I knew could do on the guitar that he couldn't do.
Oh yeah.
So he's there like practicing like for days till he got it.
Can't let her show me up.
So he's like competitive. My dad's like very competitive too, and like I'm sensing that the more I like work with them on this project. So we kind of keep it fun and just like, you know, finding where we butt heads and stuff. But it's like that's why. Like, my whole thing is where there's so many, like, talented guitarists and stuff. Like, for example, Ross is...
Oh, Ross is insane.
Like, insane guitarist.
But he can play a whole... Ross Bellenoit can play a whole lot of different kinds of guitar, too, which makes sense because he's a producer, and he has, like, he and I can go down some rabbit holes together because he and I are the same age and came up with kind of the same stuff, and we're into a lot of the same stuff.
Yeah.
But it's interesting to see like the kind of guitar, like he really goes in deep for like that 80s, big 80s production. Like he's a big Peter Gabriel fan.
Yeah, same.
In fact, like the first time I ever met him, I was in the control room at Turtle talking to Jay Levine.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I was talking to Jeff too, and we're just like chatting, and something came up about Peter Gabriel's show. Ross was not in the room, but the second we started talking about Peter Gabriel's show, suddenly Ross walks into the room, drops like two weird bits of trivia about Peter Gabriel's show, and then walks out of the room, and I'm just like, who the hell is that?
Yeah.
And they're just like, oh, it's Ross. I go, he knows a lot about Peter Gabriel.
Yeah.
And then years later, I would meet him for real, and I told him that story. He goes, yeah, he's like, it's like a dog whistle. He's like, if someone in Philadelphia is talking about Peter Gabriel.
That's like something like we like, you know, we start working together, and it's like, I told him, I was like, who is your favorite singer of all time?
Yeah.
And mine's like, I have this like balance between Nat King Cole and Peter Gabriel. Like, just like the two of them, my favorite voices of all, like male voices of all time.
Yeah.
And that was like something he was like, no, like, you know, it's like, no way. That Genesis band is just like...
It's nuts. Like,
like, thank God they broke up just because, like, you know,
Well,
Phil
thank
Collins.
God they changed and, like, he wasn't forced to kind of, like, go along. And I know people shit on, like, post-Peter Gabriel Genesis.
Yeah.
I think some of that's unfair. I think they were just... They were writing different kinds of music.
Yeah.
They were writing hits. And I don't think that one was better and one was worse, but they were definitely different because you can't deny the success of post-Peter Gabriel Genesis. Like, they made a lot of hits.
Yeah.
But, like, that really experimental, orchestrated stuff.
Yeah.
I've gone down that rabbit hole before where you just, like, for, like, a month I listened to nothing but, like, those, like, two or three big Genesis albums and just listening to it, just being like, how do you even do this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just, I love that 80s, like heavy bass.
Heavy synth bass.
Exactly. I'm starting to like explore the synth, like really into that stuff. Yeah. Like,
you like Kate Bush too? Like, she's the one who sings on Don't Give Up. And then she has a whole career of her own.
Yeah, no, I know that voice. Yeah. I never really followed that route.
That's probably one of my favorite female voices of all time is Kate Bush. And that's another, if you like Peter Gabriel and you want to see like, well, what's the weirder, artier female version of Peter Gabriel?
Okay.
It's Kate Bush.
Cool. I'll look into her then for sure.
Yeah. Oh gosh. I'm kind of jealous that you get to listen to, like, really listen to Kate Bush for the first time.
Yeah, get to be exposed.
Because I remember listening, I got her in pieces, like, in the early, late 80s and early 90s, because my father liked that stuff. And being like, who's this weird sounding lady? And then later I realized, like, oh, she's the greatest thing ever.
Yeah.
I do want to kind of know how you ended up working with Rush, but I want to get there. When did you first start writing songs for yourself? So you're young, you're learning to play guitar, and you're probably playing a lot of what, you know, songs on the radio or just like songs that you heard.
Yeah.
When did you start writing your own stuff?
I got serious with the guitar at 10. There's like a picture of me like flailing on a guitar at 2 years old.
Yeah.
it's a cute little clip because it's like I'm playing with the thing, and then there's like they had like a little kitty mic stand, and so then I get up from the mic stand and I get up from the guitar and go to the mic stand. It's like, you know, just under 2 years old, like getting the connection there.
Yeah.
So got serious with it at 10, and then it was 16 when I started like really writing. Like my first song was like 7 minutes long. Never ended.
Oh gosh,
super dramatic.
My friend Scott, who's also a songwriter musician, has a great saying about that. He says when you write your first songs and you write a chord progression, you think that you can't use those chords ever again. So you're just like, well, shit, I better write a 7 minute song with these chords.
Yeah. That's the
I better make it worth it.
Yeah, they're like, and the chords are like super grungy, and I'm like, I need to revisit these and like just really throw on some overdrive and see how it goes. But I've never gone back to those original chords, but like I would say like actually like Big Brown Eyes is probably like the third ish song I ever wrote. So like kind of picked up quickly.
Yeah.
And that ended.
That's
on
the record, right?
It is on the record. Mm-hmm. So yeah, like that was like one of the, when I wrote that song, I was like, well, I can write a song. Like, okay, all right.
It's fun just to be able to do it. Like whether it's
and it ends.
Good or not good, like it doesn't matter. It's just like, can I complete a thing?
Yeah.
Even if that thing is 7 minutes long. Mm-hmm. Like you're just like, I finished the thing. And then when you go to play it for people the first time, you're just like, oh, people don't want to listen to 7 minutes of me playing a song. I should write a shorter one the next time.
Yeah. And I like got this, it was like, was raised Catholic, so you go through these like different sacraments where, you know, your grandparents and stuff give you like nice, like generous money.
Yeah.
So like after I was like sixth grade. Yeah, confirmation was when I was the year I was like sixth, seventh grade. I used my confirmation money to get like an 8-track digi recorder.
Oh, nice.
So that was how I was like, you know, compiling.
Because that's as important as, I mean, you had guitars around the house, so like you needed to get something
recorded.
Yeah. And around the time that you would have been getting that, like there was so many more options of things you could have gotten at that time. Because for me when I was young, it was all Tascam or Fostex, like 4-track cassette. Records, which again, were still also godsends to us. The fact that you could record multiple things at once separately and like play with them.
Yeah. It was like fun to like play the little knobs and
or like being able to like
scientist about it.
Yeah, being able to like dump your tracks down and just be like, well, what if there were 9 guitars and doing that and like or like what if I track my voice so many times that it sounds like Queen, you know?
Yep. Yeah, practicing with harmonies, like harmonize. I almost kind of used it as like a loop pedal, just or like looping whatever I was doing, trying to learn how to harmonize with my own songs. I'm like just really kind of creating this idea, like. For example, like Saturday Song, like all of that was like done on that digi recorder. It's so out of sync. It's not in tone, but like the everything from, you know, well, I only had bongos at the time, but like the congas, that all of those harmonies that are in there.
Oh, that's from your. That's from your digi recorder, right?
Well, that's like that idea. Like when I crafted all those ideas.
I thought you were saying what was on the record. I go, my God, how did you do that? That's amazing.
No.
But yeah, but the idea
just
that you
the
can,
idea well, of
the
crafting.
Idea that as a solo performer you can build,
orchestrate,
you can orchestrate, you can arrange, and you can start to make choices of, well, let's have the guitar be like this, or like let's have the vocal like And like, even when deciding to do backing vocals, you're like, well, where are we going to do them?
What
are we
going to
do the words? Are we just going to go, ooh, you know, are we going to do both? In the studio for me, I call it, there's always a part in the studio for me where I'm like, we're done tracking instruments at this point. Any sounds we want after this point, we have to sing.
Mm-hmm.
And I like doing that.
Yeah.
Cause, and I got that from my brother too.
Love. That was something that Ross and I kind of, and it's funny because this was something that Jay told me. He was like, you know, Ross is going to give you kickback on adding more harmonies. He was like, but I want to give you the heads up that he's going to do that so you can tell him to put them in there anyway.
Yeah.
So there was a couple times where I was like, he's like, I don't think we need it. I was like, yeah, we do. Like,
yeah.
Well,
yeah.
We're doing it.
Yeah. So, well.
And then like we would like double a vocal track or something, and he'd be like, damn it, Brie, like you know what you're doing. Like,
yeah,
you got it.
That's the fun of Ross, is that like he can be like, I don't know. And then when you show him something, he's like, no, this is the greatest thing ever.
Yeah. He's like, nope, that makes the song.
Yep. And that's always the great thing about working with good producers.
Yeah.
Like, you know, because you want to work with someone with a depth of knowledge and experience.
Exactly.
You want to work with someone who kind of comes at it, or at least speaks your language or has influences, and then you want to work with someone who also is enough of a professional who just be like, hey, we'll try whatever you want, you know,
but like also cares. Like I would appreciate those times when we would, you know, have a discussion about a particular piece of the track, because it's like, you know, I'm sitting there talking to this man like about my song, but he's also passionate about my
like
song.
He's super
so
into
it's
it.
Like
yeah.
You know, at those, that's when the best things happened.
Yeah. How did you end up? Well, let's see. So you're 16, you're writing songs. Obviously, mm-hmm. there's a big jump between 16 and now.
Mm-hmm.
You went to school, I imagine.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
At Temple?
Temple. Mm-hmm.
Yep. For music or?
No. So I went to Temple's business school.
Yep.
So yeah, my degree is it's management information systems, which I actually got into that from like learning recording software. I was like, I can teach myself software and be super analytical with these softwares. Like,
oh, cool. What were some of the first, were you like using Pro Tools and things like that?
Yeah. And then my computer crashed. But, you know, it's one of those things that comes from like, you know, teaching yourself the guitar. It's like, well, if I can teach myself the guitar, I can do this. It's almost like if you tell me something's difficult, I'm going to roll up my sleeves, bury my head and go for it.
Your answer is like, how difficult?
Yeah.
No, it's true. And that's the great thing about, I mean, that is literally that's the seed of DIY music is like being like, well, no, like you didn't have a band, it seemed. I don't know. Did you play in bands at all or like playing ensembles?
Yeah. So it was like going to Temple was really cool.
They got a fun little music scene. Yeah. And college in general, you always kind of meet. You meet the songwriters on your floor in your dorm or like around, and that's always a good.
And what I'll say, because I kind of want to give a shout out to my like high school, because I really kind of grew my songwriting in high school as well. And that's where I got my confidence, you know, writing songs, singing them, because like at all those concerts in high school, I went to Nazareth. It's in Northeast Nazareth Academy. But, you know, just like, you know, performing those songs in front of 400 people, like, you know, 360 girls, but 400 people.
That'll get over the stage. Yeah. The stage theater's pretty quick.
And then having like,
and your
you
peers
know,
too. Yeah. It's not like they're adults who are going to like politely clap no matter what
it
is. Like, these are your peers and you got to see these people
girls.
After you're done too.
Girls are so, you know.
Or at that age too. Like, and everyone is just, everyone's super critical.
It was cool. Yeah. It's like, so I never really got into theory. Was never like a theory person, you know, like even like recording the songs like with Ross, I was like, he's like, what key is it in?
Like, I don't know.
you know, so like, so yeah, now I know the keys of my songs.
Oh, that's good.
just like never was into theory, but there's this one teacher, Mrs. Lafferty. She like kind of took me under her wing in the sense that, and it just so happened and it worked out because she was the director of the music program there. So she kind of made all the shots, but you know, she just like kind of had my back in the sense that she, like when I got there, I was way more advanced in my guitar playing than I was in my reading. And like we would be in lessons and she would play it and then I would just play it after hearing it.
Yeah. Oh,
so
yeah.
I would be like, yeah, pretending to read. Like,
well, you had a bit of a leg up too because you had, you know, you've been playing the guitar for a lot longer. Like for you saying you really start playing the guitar around 10 is you had a good few years.
Yeah, exactly.
Because I mean, I know myself and a lot of my peers didn't really start maybe 12, 13, even 14.
Yeah.
So for you to already have a jump on it right there and to have the resource of your dad and your dad's band friends around to kind of...
You
had a bar to shoot for right there, and that bar seemed pretty high.
Yeah, she just really had my back. It's like, you think back, because like even when I'll jump like in, like going to Temple, there are like certain teachers that are super impactful, and she was somebody who totally had my back in the sense she's like, this is Bray, she's not gonna learn much theory, but she will learn some theory.
Yeah.
But like she's good. We're gonna hone in on this like songwriting ability that she has.
Yeah.
And just, you know, like in the different recitals and stuff, like a lot of girls were doing show tunes in the years before us.
Yeah.
And then we jumped in there and like did like Guster and Kook songs, like like things that weren't even on like the local radio, just like songs that I liked to like play on the guitar and like just performed at those recitals. And then I ultimately was like doing, you know, original songs and performing those in front of like different recitals and stuff. And it was cool because like parents were coming up to me. Just like it was a good exposure there to get confidence with
it. Yeah. It's good to put your stuff out there and see the reaction.
Yeah.
And it then helps you go and write more because you can kind of tell what works and doesn't work. Even at that age, like I said, some people, it's your peers can be critical, but also at that age, people can be very congratulatory just because they don't want to. They don't want to wreck you at that point.
You don't have to, like, and that's the thing, like, people don't have to seek you out to come let you know that you did well. Like, that was cool what you did.
But you would get a feel for, like, what was working.
Genuine,
even if people said, like, I like that, in your head, you're just like, okay. But in your head, you're just like, well, that wasn't as good as I'd like it to be.
So yeah, you exactly. You're competitive with yourself.
Yeah.
It's that perfectionist aspect of it. But, yeah, and then from there, I went to Temple. And, like, I wanted to. Wasn't sure if I wanted to go for music industry. I knew I kind of wanted to do business. And as the younger sister learning from your older sibling and how they went about their, life. My brother went to Pitt. When he graduated in 2008, like an awful time to graduate from college. So there was like that stress in terms of me making the decision to go for music industry or to go for business and then try to work my way into the music industry. But like,
if it'd even still be there.
Yeah. And that's the thing. It was just like, there was like a lot of fear. Like I was, you know, was applying. I knew I wanted to be in a city.
Yeah. Well, you're lucky you were near a good one. So
yeah. And like, and was looking at like Drexel, Hofstra had another music industry, but they were actually like in Long Island. They weren't in the city.
Yeah.
And then Temple, like when I went to Temple's campus, I just was like, this is home.
Yeah.
This is
it's got a nice little, I've met a lot of people who sort of cut their teeth songwriting wise in sort of the tent, like, because there was like coffee house, open mics, and things
so MEISA,
like that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, and that's the thing. So, it like freshman, that freshman orientation week, you go to the club, and like I saw this table there that had all these like drums and a sitar and like all these like cool things. And I was like, what is this? And then, like, it was funny because I was the only business student, like, in the whole club.
Yeah.
So it was easy to, like, kind of, you know, apply myself as the treasurer of MEISA. So they, like, appointed me as the treasurer. And I was, like, you know, got to, like, help influence us, like, let's throw parties and, like, make money for t-shirts at parties and, like, do all these things. So it was just kind of cool to get myself involved and ended up, like, becoming the president of MEISA. And it was just so funny because we were basically, like, this, like, open mic brigade going around. Like, that's how I met Abby Reimold, was through MEISA.
Oh, yeah. Oh, gosh. She's...
Just amazing.
She's like, freaking nuts. Yeah. Like, the guitarist. I don't mean nuts in her head. Like, I just mean, like, she's...
Just, yeah.
God.
She is like
she comes up a lot on this show and we have a very similar guy where everyone's just like, oh man.
Yeah, she's just awesome and so genuine. Yeah. I consider her like what I like to call a Renaissance woman. Like she is just,
she's a great photographer.
Yeah, exactly.
She's an amazing performer.
Yeah.
She's really, really dialed in how to use her loop pedal.
Really cool because like I saw her as a freshman at like a Temple.
Yeah.
You know, she was new. Like, I was like, I had, like, she was brand new to songwriting at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, I think she came up to me after, like, a set that I did, and she was like, you're the best. And then I was like, you're a voice. Like,
yeah.
You're
a
voice, though. Like, she's like, I'm, like, my songs were, like, you know, it's like, just keep doing it. Like,
yeah. This is becoming the Abby Reimold podcast.
Yeah, right. Just talking about the love of Abby. I mean, she's like been a friend of mine for a long time.
I found her record because it came out in like January of that year through John at XPN or something like that is probably the person who kind of put it in front of me. And when you get to a certain age, kind of moving towards your mid-30s, which was where I, early 30s, mid-30s, which is what I was when I heard the record, you kind of think that you're done, like, getting your hair blown back by stuff. You're just like, I like what I like, and I can, you know, I can listen to all kinds of stuff, but I'm like, you know, I've got this stuff that I identify with, that I dial into.
Yeah.
And then I heard that record, and I was just like, what is, like, I was like, my God, I'm like, it's like being like 17 again and like hearing something that you just couldn't wrap your brain around and just being like, I gotta figure this out. That's how I was with that record.
It's an amazing record.
Anyways, your record.
Yeah.
how did you make the choice to record a turtle?
I think they're
one of the higher end studios in the city for talent, and not just equipment but talent and just the way that they work with artists.
Yeah, they're a great, fantastic group of people. Like, they are, I never have felt so comfortable there, right? And taken care of, right?
Which is great that they're able to do that, because it is that, like, especially their studio, like, that studio's got some history to it, and it's an intimidating place, I would imagine, as a young artist, an intimidating place, especially to make your first, you know, record.
I met Jay at a singer-songwriter competition that I lost, but I came in second, but I think there were three judges, and I think I won Jay's vote.
Yeah.
But,
which meant that if you just given him long enough, he just would have talked to everyone around.
That's the thing. Like, I was talking to him. Like, he was like, the other guy didn't even, he didn't even get to record here. Like, I don't, because that was like, if you won, you got to record at Turtle.
Yeah.
But I ended up just talking to Jay, and he was like really curious about the songs that I was writing, and like, you know, and just, you know, I ended up going in there with my dad, like, right in college, and he wanted me to record then, and I was like, oh my God, I have to finish college, I have no money.
And also just, like, I have to write stuff that
I want to keep writing.
I want to write some stuff worthy of being, of going in a place like this. Well, that's good. I mean, and Jay is an incredibly supportive dude, especially for younger artists in this city. He's a jazz guy, too, but, like, he's turned me on to a lot
it's
of younger...
It's funny, we connect on the like IT side of things too, because he's also an IT consultant.
And he's a big prog rock guy too, I always think of him as the jazz guy because he loves that, and he just really reaches out to a lot of different people, and
he's just a cool dude.
He's an all-around common person for people to know, like you'll find a lot of people who have like common
everybody knows Jay. I'm working on a music video for 2 a.m. with actually like Mike Sassani was the guy from Recall. He passed away, but I'm working with his daughter Krista, who is a dancer, and she's like, she lives in Collingswood, like in Jay's neighborhood, so she like knows Jay. She also knows Ross. It's like a weird connection.
Philly ain't that big, a city, but in the scene, and I've said this so many times before, like, it doesn't take long to like know a good number, not everyone obviously, but a good number of people worth knowing. Like,
And
it's not like New York or LA where like it's just so huge and there's a lot of gatekeepers that you can even prevent you to have access to certain people. In Philly, we don't, you know, we don't roll like that.
Yeah. And it's funny because like our dads went to Archbishop Ryan. It's like that Northeast big school. There's that whole little like melting pot of like that Irish Catholic, like, Catholic schools, like there's like, you know, Nazareth, Hubert's, Judge, Ryan.
And a lot of families.
And everybody knows everybody.
Yeah, and a lot of families and generations didn't really leave, so everyone kind of just sort of builds.
And like, you know, so many years later, like her and I are connecting on these people who have no relation to that. But, you know, it's, it was just like, I just was kind of like ready, like I was like working hard and like saving my money because this was something that I wanted to do. Hit up Jay, and I wrote down the names of like 50 of my songs, like went into the studio, remembered the name of the song and like sang it, and then we picked the song, and it was a really cool way to go about it, because he was like, well, if the song is good with just you and a guitar, it's gonna be good, orchestrated, you know.
Oh, so you just kind of just kind of hit out demo versions of it, like right
like it was sat there for like 2 hours, and he was like, do you want a break songs. And I was like, no
let's just keep doing
I've been waiting for years to do this. I have endless energy right now.
Yes. Did he pair you with Ross?
Yeah, he did. He paired me right away with Ross. He was like, yeah, I think you should work with Ross. And it was just like fun. Like I wanted a lot of harmonies. You know, and I also, like, it's interesting. I love to dance too, so I'm actually getting into, like, I will work with like producers now to like remix some songs. But I wanted it to be like, you know, like the guitar is the avenue in which I've used to write songs, but I plan to explore other avenues of like creating and recording songs. But this being the first record, I kind of just wanted this to be home base of everything.
Yeah. Ain't nothing wrong with a guitar album.
Exactly, right? And like the guitar will always be a part of me in my sound, but I really just wanted it to be, it's so funny, like just like, oh, this is the Tom Petty song. Oh, well, this is the, like, you know, the Jack Johnson song. Or this is the, I don't know, this is the Amy Winehouse, like, you know, slow going song. It's nice. It was just like fun, and I was just, he's a communicative genius in the sense, like, you know, going in there on like the basics day, working with those, like the musicians. Right? He's just like, you know, I want like an upbeat Tom Petty with an undertone of like, you know, John Lennon or whatever, like, you know, but like John Bonham drums, and then like, but like, you know, Tom Petty, like, whatever. And then like
and then
four
they just
takes,
do it.
And then four takes, and it's done. And it's like, all right, this is
well,
cool.
They've got a good crop of people that they use.
He knew exactly what he was doing, and it was incredible to just like learn from him and how he collaborated with me in terms of maybe just like tweaking a chord in the song. Like, we didn't change anything of the song.
Yeah,
in the sense maybe we
just
like
tweaking
repeated
voicings
a verse
or
somewhere.
Yeah,
and like just the structure of the song, which that's like, I like, for me, like the songwriting is like my, that's like my, I would call like my genius, like the guitar, the singing are two things that I really work extremely, extremely hard at.
Yeah.
The songwriting is something I would say that like, it's like that divine intervention, something that just kind of came to me. But it's also something where it's a craft that I certainly want to hone in on. And then just like learning from Ross and how he worked with me, a pre-existing song, it's just something that I kind of want to repeat with other songwriters, to just like be, you know, that board to just bounce ideas off of and like make the existing song that somebody has even better.
That's true. Yeah. Because in collaboration, you can always make your thing stronger.
Yeah. That's my like goal of 2019 is to collaborate.
Yeah. And it's hard because a singer songwriter, that's always thought of as being more of, it's a solo, like a one person thing.
No. And that's like the thing, like really just like embracing the fact that music is meant to be a collaborative sport.
Yeah.
And I've always been an athlete too. So
yeah.
Like, just all, I'm like, really want to just embrace the team player-ness of everything.
It's true. It tends to make everything better. And then it's fun when it's just more fun too.
Yeah.
Than just sitting by yourself writing songs. At some point you have to bring them out to others, and you have to kind of start hearing what people think.
Yeah.
And then going from there and like deciding, you know, what it is you want to do about that. I'm not a big like lyric dissector. That's not really what I do. But like, as I was listening to the record a few times over the last couple of weeks, I'm like, my favorite songs in this record are the ones where she's like basically telling dudes to shut up,
to F off.
Yeah, but I like that too, and it got me thinking about like, oh, that's, you know, that's a great thing. You know, that's not a new thing, but like, and I thought to myself, it's not a new thing. Like, women have been writing songs like this for decades and forever. It's only now, you know, in sort of current climates that like, we're giving a lot more attention to that. But I imagine with you, you've, not only is it just, you know, not difficulty, but like there's the challenge of being a female musician and being taken seriously as an actual author and writer instead of just a singer.
Yeah.
And then to be an electric guitar player too, which is like predominantly a dude's world right there. That's got to be an interesting interesting for you to go into certain situations and people to have certain preconceived ideas what you can and can't do.
Yeah.
And then being able to just sort of get rid of all those by just doing your thing.
Yeah, and that's actually something that's just innately has always been me. Like, my mom was pumped to be having a daughter and was like, oh, it's going to be a princess. And, like, I was that girl who hated dresses. Like, like, crying, like, in this beautiful dress, just, like an absolute crazy child, just, like, hating the dress.
Yeah.
And then, like, ultimately, she would let me wear my brother's clothes, so I was, and then I was really into sports. So, like, I was out there, like, at lunchtime, like, playing football with the boys, and, like, if a kid, like, pushed me hard, like, I would get up and punch him in the face. Like, there's, yeah, so I just was always, like, extremely competitive, you know, and that, like, not to bring it always back to, like, IT, but also male predominantly
definitely.
Industry, you know, and it's really just what actually comes back to it all. And what I have found is, like, my ability to talk sports very helpful, and music is, like, very helpful. I can easily, you know, that's a good way to build rapport and communicate.
Yeah.
Like, it's not,
it's unfortunate that it takes the sports to do it, but
It's a good crutch, you know?
No, it's true. And in the workplace, because no one wants to talk about, you know, more sensitive topics. Sports and music are always, sports, music, and food are always three very safe
what's
topics.
For lunch, and, like, how did the birds do? It's just, so I've just always, that's always been innately me, you know, and then, you know, obviously, like, growing up in, like working with, like, boys and, like liking boys and getting into them, but, like, also dealing with those other societal issues that happen in general day-to-day life. But, you know, and just kind of writing it down, and just what I found, like, it actually, like, been extremely reflective in this past few months, I would say. For example, long haul, super direct song. Like, this happened. This is what I'm going to write about. This is what I wish I said or could have said. And then our decent excuse, like, that was Ross's favorite. He's like, man, like, girls don't tell boys they're not worth it enough. You know, as I grew up, it was always nice to have music as a connection with my dad. Maturing and be like, you know, like, growing up, like, that separation happens, but music was something we could always come back to. So I've always had a really strong relationship with my dad, really strong relationship with my brother. My parents have been, you know, married for 41 years, I think, now.
Wow, good for them.
Yeah, really long time. And I'm also their best friend, so, like, I know a lot. But
that's good. And it's good to have that rock, that sort of foundation to go back on.
And it's something to go back on, in the sense that, you know, walking into, like, shitty boys, or, like, I understood why it wasn't worth it.
You had made them hate me
so I could leave.
You had a good base of self-worth. Well, that's good.
Took time to find.
I think you had a good base that probably better than maybe a lot of other younger people have, because,
like,
you
very fortunate,
like,
for that.
The things that you liked to do, play guitar, play sports and all that, it sounds like you had a pretty good support network just in your immediate family, just with your dad and your brother, like, just musically, for a young woman to want to play guitar, for a girl to want
to
play guitar.
To have two guys being like,
and then your dad's friends and all that being like, this is great. Like, there was no, like, oh, she's a good guitar player for a girl. They were just like,
no, she's great.
and that's all. And I can hear, like, in the guitar playing too, like, in the lead, I was just like, this is some real, like, some real rootsy, you know, blues rock stuff, which is not always... You know, you always think that when girls do play the guitar, it's always the acoustic guitar, and it's...
That's exactly why I got away from the acoustic guitar, especially, like, being 27 and Taylor Swift being a thing. Like,
Who else do you kind of consider your contemporaries in Philly? Like, who else were you kind of playing around with as you were sort of figuring it out? Because I know we definitely talked about Abby.
Yeah.
But who else was around? Or who else do you like to play with now?
So I play with... just people that I've, like, CT Thorne, she's another singer-songwriter. She wrote Joan of Arc. Her one song is Joan of Arc. She also recorded a turtle with Ross. Brittany Ann Tramball is also another incredible talent. Just another temple. Everybody from that Temple Mesa, like, I think I was looking at all the people you've talked to in, like, Port Arthur.
Oh, you know Luke, yeah.
Yeah, Luke was there.
That's so funny. Like I said, you guys are all about the same age, and you all kind of...
There's a solid crew in that, like, we were literally the open mic brigade. Like, we would go to places and just take over their open mic.
That's fun. That's like, great.
It was cool. And it was just...
It's good to do it in a group, too. It's like, good to have kind of strength in numbers.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, we would do that World Cafe Live thing on Monday.
Yep.
We'd kill it. Like, it was just
go get there 5:30 to sit in line. And
it sounded like everybody had fans because we all got loud. And it was like it was like a preemptive thing. It was like, everybody needs to cheer loud for everybody who's from MEISA up there. Like, loud. Yeah, it was a good spot. It was like, that was like the because we did a lot of open mics with Saxby's, and it was like funny the system that we had because it was my dad's like super old PA system. And I'm done carrying this thing. Like, like boys, get out there. And
someone move this thing. It's heavy and old.
It's so heavy. And it would just be like you know, that would be like the practice spot. And we'd be like, okay, we're gonna go in this brigade, because then it got really big, and it was just like, it was cool, and like the different house shows that we organized based on like hip hop and other female songwriters, and just really like kind of opening that door for girls too. I think like there are going back to my like high school music teacher, there's that one professor at Temple who told me like. Because I went there for marketing and to go to who's like the Gen Ed MIS guy, and he was like, you know, we need like assertive, like well-rounded women, more women in MIS, and I think you can do this. But I think that like there's those moments in my life where like it was mostly men who told me like, you know, like you can do this, like you should do this. But I like really take to heart those moments where I think like you need to just tell girls to like go for it. Like, who cares? Like, everybody's scared.
Yeah.
Nobody's really like...
No one knows what they're doing.
Yeah. It's like everybody's afraid, but you just got to get out there and do it anyway.
Yeah.
And just kind of...
It's a fun thing to learn as you get older. It's like no one has the answer.
Yeah.
Like, no. And everyone's still, even my age and older, like just...
Yeah.
Just kind of...
No one's fearless.
Or we're still kind of just faking it.
Yeah, like, fake it till you make it. It's like my motto of life.
Yeah, the number of times I'll go up and like play or like work with other people, and people are like, "Wow, that was so good!" And me, my mind being like, "I literally just pulled that out of the air."
Yeah,
like,
yeah. And that's.
But you have the skill, like you hone the skill set to be able to.
Yeah, like prepare.
Yeah,
as well, much as you can, to be prepared.
Be prepared. Practice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like. Practice in front of people and practice in front of different kinds of groups of people.
Yeah, because that's the thing, like, especially with the electric guitar, like, I told myself, like, if I'm going to do this and then be taken seriously, I need to, like, be legit.
Yeah, I gotta be good. Yeah.
Really good.
So, and even harder as a young woman, too, because, like, you know, a guy can kind of roll in, you know, stereotypically, and like have, you know, a few of the licks, you know, just have a couple of guitar tricks, and people can just be like, yeah, he's a guitar player. But if it's to your advantage, but it's unfortunate that you have to be so much better.
Yeah. And that's the thing. It's like, I think it's not necessarily better, but there's a certain level that you have to be
so much more polished. You have to be so much more capable.
Which in the end, it's like, and that's the thing, like, sometimes the most talented people aren't necessarily the ones who make it.
Yeah.
But like, and it's just like the one, you know, it's just, for me, it's like, if I'm going to do anything, I'm going to try to be the best at it. And that's like something where I really want to take my like lead playing to the next level. And that's like another goal for me for this year, is to really just focus on my lead. And that's why I got the Jag.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's going to make it
easier. It's a good guitar to focus on lead on.
Yeah. Yeah. And tone, right?
Yeah. We have all those, get all kinds of options.
Yeah. A lot of options. It's just like, it's fun. And it's just, and then, you know, having, because like, I meet, you know, people like Ross, there's different people that I've played like guitar with, like just like the jazz band in high school. Like there's this kid out in LA, his name's Chris Griotti, and he shreds, but he's like producing things for like Grimes and Poppy and different things like that. He is out there. But like, I think like in terms of the best guitarist I've ever met, it's like that kid and Ross. Yeah. Like they're just the ones. And it's just, you know, it's, I don't think I'll let, that's like a level of prodigy, I would say. Yeah. I mean, but like, if I can be as good as my dad, then I'm like, I'm there. I'm there.
I mean, someone like Ross or any of his contemporaries, just remember, they've got a handful of years on you. Mm-hmm. Like, just they've just simply been doing it longer.
Yeah. Now I'm really trying to learn the theory of the guitar.
Yeah.
Like, just the guitar.
Not even just music theory, but like, the theory of the guitar.
What key is this in? Yeah. Where can I have my licks? And then learn the different scales and when they work. And just really kind of exploring it and learning different licks of, you know, different like famous solos. Yeah. And just trying to add that to my repertoire.
Wait till you go down the chromatics rabbit hole, and then suddenly you realize, like, oh, this is what this takes you from being a good guitar player to like a really good guitar player.
Yeah, like
when you figure out all the notes you can put in between and when you can do
the wrong notes.
Figuring out when to use
like
the wrong notes.
To
me, it's the Jerry Garcia play where it's you're just like, that shouldn't work, and you figure that out. I've done that in the last year. I've really been kind of dialing in chromatic scales.
Yeah.
And just figuring out, and because I'm a big Grateful Dead fan.
Cool.
So
hell yeah.
So I'm just kind of figuring out, and then when you stumble across certain chromatic things, and you have to stop, it's like, oh my god, that's Jerry. There's certain certain little voicings and stuff, like going in, moving between major scales chromatically, and just like, oh, that's. That's what he was doing.
Yeah.
Like,
it's a lot of fun, and it's this whole new world, and I kind of make sure I do my drills every day.
Yeah.
That's good.
I'm not nearly that disciplined.
And I'm trying to like, it's like my, like my pinky tends to be so far away from the neck, and it's like, when you see the guys doing it really fast, like that pinky's right there with the other hand. So
unless you're Eric Clapton, then you're not using it at all.
Yeah. And that's like how my dad is too. He doesn't use that pinky. I was like, well, it's going to separate me. Like,
yeah. No, it separated me for a long time too, until, you just kind of look at it. You just be like, you got to work as hard as the rest of these guys here.
Yeah.
And you have to not like, leave it out because it's the smaller, weaker finger.
Yeah,
you have to be like,
try
no,
and like learn how to bend with it. Like, we'll somehow
get
there.
Bend with it. Yeah, I can bend with the ring. Like, I can pop that in there.
Yeah.
My pinky strength actually got a lot better playing the bass, especially in first position. And I got pretty big hands, but to reach, to like really hit that first position scale.
Get the strength of your
And you got to push down a bass string too. It's not a guitar string.
I really want to get into bass. Like, I'm like, looking, I'm we'll probably hit up Sam Ash and Franklin Mills or the Mills, and we'll and invest in a bass too, just because I want to have that in my like back pocket, like, oh, I can play bass, because I just really want to collaborate with people, and just I know I can pick up songs quickly and add things.
The bass is my instrument that I can walk into more situations and hold my own a little bit. Like, I'm a guitar player by, like, that's what I was originally. And I can drum a little bit, and I can kind of pass around on the piano a little bit. Like, that's something I taught myself over the last couple of years. But bass is the one I can walk into a situation that I'm the least prepared for and still kind of make it happen. And I toured on bass for a while too.
Cool.
And like, you play bass every night, and you pick up on it.
You
figure out how you're gonna do it.
Yeah,
because many times I had played bass in situations where I wasn't a bass player, but I was just a guitar player who was playing bass.
Yeah,
and somewhere in there, towards like the more active part of me playing a lot, I realized what kind of bass. Like, I realized, like, oh, I'm actually playing this like a bass player now.
Yeah,
figuring out like.
And us chick bass players are like the best.
Just the best. Yeah. It's coolest. Always the stereotype in the 90s of like, you know, grungy dude rock band
and one, a chick bass.
And one lady bass player, but like some of the best. Yeah.
But that's always like, that's also like a competitive side of me. It's like, well, I want to be the guitarist. Like,
yeah.
I want to be the guitarist up there, the chick guitarist. Yeah. Right. Or at least the rhythm, you know, because there's so many guys out there who are just really good. But
yeah. There's a lot of ladies out there who are realizing more and more, like someone like St. Vincent or something.
There's actually like a statistic out there. There is a statistic out there, especially with like, you know, the positives of social media with things like Instagram out there. There is a statistic of like young girls picking up the guitar more.
Yeah,
and more.
I think I read that recently.
Super exciting.
Like more girls are picking up the guitar now than ever before.
Because that's the thing. Like for me, it was like when I went to like Toys R Us, it was like I went straight to the boys section. But now it's like that girl who wrote a letter to Lego. Like, do you only have princesses, and why are there no female scientists in your Lego collection? Like, why?
Yeah.
And they like wrote her back and they were like, we'll fix that. You know?
We'll make them.
Yes. And it was just That's like the 7-year-old
we'll
girl. Like,
we'll just paint them differently.
Whoever, like, what, go her parents.
Yes, yes. Go her parents is
yeah.
right.
Yeah. But yeah, just like different things. That's just always like been a competitive piece for me and very competitive.
Yeah. Do you want to play a song?
Sure.
Cool. Let's get that ready. What's this one called?
2 a.m.
Okay.
Cool.
This is the one on your can cozy.
Yes. Drunk. It's inspired by a phone call to my parents. Yeah.
Where you needed something?
Yeah, it was like the you know, you have that moment where you're kind of like going a little crazy.
Yeah.
And you just like it's like that phone call is almost like a lifeline.
Yeah.
So you're calling somebody. And at that point in time, like actually the phone call started at midnight and it ended at 2.
Okay.
Or like, right, it was like, it was like close to 2.
Close
but
enough
I remember
that
like
2,
writing down lyrics, still hammered. And I was just being like, didn't want to call you. It's late, but it's 2 a.m. and like, you know, all these things.
Yeah.
Like, just that's kind of what started the idea of it. And it was just all about just that. That was like very coming of age time, just very frustrated. Just it was like I was a freshman at Temple. Just like, you know, there was so much coming at me, but also trying to like embrace that but stay true to myself and not, you know, let the bad things that happened to me change my perspective of the world. And that was the struggle of like something when things like hurt you. Or, like, when things hurt you, it's like, I'm determined to not make this, have this, have, make me hate, like, have hate, basically.
Yeah, you're not going to let the world harden you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But also, you got to be protective of yourself.
Yeah. Oh, and it doesn't get any easier.
Doesn't get any easier.
I wish I could tell you that it did, but it doesn't.
Yeah, it doesn't. That's actually a great, like, don't let the world harden you.
Yeah,
That's the truth, yeah.
Yep.
It was the struggle.
To call you, and I know it's late right now, but I'm drunk and it's 2 a.m. So listen and listen loud. I'm tired and angry, and I don't know why, but the world keeps trying to change cannot divide. I don't want to live in the past, but I'm still fighting to catch my breath. No miracle's gonna save me, so I better change fast. I hate myself. It's time and time again. I break myself. Where did my mind go? Place I called home, 'cause now I'm running around in circles, away from feeling alone. I believe in the road that leads to heaven above, but why is mine so goddamn? Myself. It's time and time again, I break myself. I didn't say I'm crazy. Feel perfectly sane. Denial it just maybe. Still my burden to tame.
That was great.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Did you want to do another one? Or you...
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm going to do Lady. It's a love song. I met my fiance at a frat party freshman year. But he actually, in a very classy, and I think there's three people in my lifetime who've actually asked me to dance. Like, it's really this gross societal thing where people just go up to you and grab you. It was really like that scene was.
It is a gross societal thing, yes, yeah. Where men just go up and grab.
Yeah, it was like I only did that, like, went to parties like that freshman year, and just thankful.
That's when you go to those parties. Yeah,
that's what you do.
You don't know any better.
Yeah, exactly. But he is somebody who tapped me on the shoulder and actually asked me to dance, and it was funny because we moved into our first apartment at right on Fairmount. Like 15th and Wallace. I was watching a lot of Game of Thrones and you know, it was always like, actually, like, Always Does It Well and Aren't You Marry Me. Love that song. It's like super punky.
Yeah.
But like, I was one of those things where I was like, basically, like, I didn't want to say like marry me or like be that direct, but like in Game of Thrones, like, married women are ladies.
Yeah.
That's like what I was saying with it. So,
oh, okay.
That's where the term lady comes, and that's what it meant.
Waking out in a brand new apartment, thinking thoughts, thinking of the night you asked me to dance, 'cause dancing the way to my heart. The music has changed, but we remain dancing as lovers do. There's no other way I'd spend my days, 'cause I'm dancing with you. Oh, swing me, sway me, always call me baby. You are gonna save me, make me your lady.
All right.
Cool.
That was good.
Thanks.
Well, thanks so much for coming.
Yeah.
And for playing. And now I've realized that I've stumbled upon a crew of, like, you, Abby, Luke, yeah. That sort of, what did you say, the MEISA was the name of the...
Yeah, Temple's Music Entertainment Industry Student Association.
Gotcha. I would not have guessed the I in there, but yeah.
Yeah.
That's wild. I didn't know that existed, but that makes a lot of sense now that I meet these people of who came from Temple. Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome.
It was a good time.
Well, thanks so much for coming.
Thank you. We'll be together till the end of time. 25
Well, that's the show for this week. Thank you so much for hanging out. Thank you for listening. Thank you, Brianna Judge, for being on the show, for being my first guest of 2019. I really, really dug talking to her. She has a record out. It's new. It's called Wide Eyes. You can get it at her website, briannajudgemusic.com, and anywhere else you get music, iTunes, Spotify, all the places. I can't keep up. I'm an older dude. I don't want to say old. I'm not an old person, but I'm an older person, and I can't keep up. Check out her music, briannajudgemusic.com. She's playing at Puck in Doylestown on March 30th. But go to her website, sign up for a mailing list, and you'll be kept in the loop of all things Brianna Judge. So thank you, Brianna. You are a champ. That's going to be the show for this week. I don't have an extended outro. I had an extended enough intro. That's the show for this week. Thank you for listening. Thank you for checking it out. Go to 25oclockpod.com for everything else. All the old episodes, streaming and downloading. Join the mailing list. Find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Special mention about the venue, the Music Ward this week. 5101 Grace Ferry Avenue in Philadelphia, a DIY music venue. Check them out, themusicward.com. I think I've done it. I think I've shilled enough for everyone, including myself, at this point in the show. You're listening to 25 O'Clock. You were listening to 25 O'Clock. You have been listening to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining in. Until next time, take care of yourselves.